Guys, I'm excited to be here. We're going to hit the ground running.
Meet Iowa City's new chief of police as I sit down with Jody Matherly. Plus, learn why the ICPD collects data on every traffic stop they make.
It holds us accountable.
And ever wonder where your water comes from? See how the city processes high-quality H2O. Lastly, learn about a new pilot program for food trucks. And it all starts right now on this edition of Iowa City in Focus. The Iowa City Police Department has a new leader. Jody Matherly was chosen as the 46th Chief of Police in Iowa City. I recently sat down with Chief Matherly to discuss his vision for the Iowa City Police Department. Chief Matherly, thanks for taking the time to meet with me.
Well, thank you for coming. I appreciate it.
You began your law enforcement career in Flint, Michigan, and most recently served as police chief in Altoona, Iowa. What was it about Iowa City that led you to pursue this job?
You know, Iowa City is a combination of all the cities that I've worked in. And as I get here and just finish my second week, I find that it's very similar to Flint, Michigan, even down to the character of our police department, the building itself. You know, this is the place where I can, hit on all the experience that I've had overall, from the busyness of the interstate to the activities in town here, the metropolitan type setting. But also the citizens in the community itself are similar to the folks in Grinnell and Altoona. It's a good Iowa town.
From what you've seen so far, what are some of the strongest qualities you've seen in the Iowa City Police Department? And what are some areas that you see room for improvement?
It seems cliche to say it's the people, but it truly is the staff here. You know, from the folks at the front door that welcome you to the records clerks, to the officers themselves and up to the command staff, including our community outreach officers and community service officers. This is a very diverse group. They're a very well-trained group, and they could not have been more welcoming to me. And I think that's a reflection on how they interact with the community itself. So there's some really good people here. You know, the second part of your question, as far as improvements, you know, I'm a systems type of person, and I look at, you know, how things are operating. Are we being as efficient as we can be? Is a particular unit or division being worked more than it should be, and can we delegate some of that work elsewhere? So we're looking at all of that, and the command staff here has a good grasp on what their duties are, and they are pretty good at telling me, you know, where we can make adjustments. So we're evaluating those systems, and I think that's a priority for us, is to make sure that our work is being done completely and with expertise and not just a jack of all trades, master of none. We don't want that.
The city has participated in a series of studies that have shown the disproportionality of traffic stops of minorities has gone down, but still African Americans and Hispanics are more likely to get pulled over. How do you see the department addressing that issue?
Well, this isn't necessarily an Iowa City issue. It's a nationwide issue. And the reality is this. If those numbers are showing that, which we've shown that they are, the mere perception that could be occurring is troublesome for anybody. That is priority number one for our city council. It's priority number one for our citizens. And it's certainly priority number one for me. We cannot begin to earn the trust of our community until this is resolved. We need to get rid of the race to crime ratio or association and dispel that. And that comes with training and implicit bias. So we need to continue to work on that. That's number one. We need to look at how we're deploying our resources and make sure that we're addressing crime trends and not entire communities, particularly communities of color. At the end of the day, procedural justice is so important. We need to make sure that we're treating people with respect when we do deal with them, and that we're being as professional as we can and as fair and consistent as we can. And the message has been clear to my staff since I've been here. And I can tell you, they're open for change. They're open for solutions. They're doing a good job out there. And I want to make sure that I stand by them, but we also address this issue.
We will continue my interview with Chief Matherly in just a few moments, but I wanted to take the time to break down the study that I referenced about contact with minorities. It was over a decade ago that the Iowa City Police Department began collecting data on traffic stops in order to be proactive about the issue.
I think disparity is there in law enforcement and the judicial system throughout the country, and we're just trying to do business a little better.
10 traffic.
With the idea of tackling the issue head on, the police department decided to team up with Dr. Christopher Barnum, a professor of criminal justice at St. Ambrose University.
And this has been a long-term investment in time and energy for the police department.
Beginning in 2006, Dr. Barnum and his team set up a system for officers to collect data during traffic stops. The statistics collected can then be used to compare to the study's baseline, which is determined by census data and roadside observations that have been made over the past 10 years.
A good ballpark figure for most areas of Iowa City, both day and night, is about 10% of the drivers on the roads are minority drivers.
The goal is to identify discrepancies in the numbers.
We want to see what it is we're doing and where we can improve.
Here's how it works. Whenever a traffic officer makes a stop,
put your window up, stay warm, I'll be right back with you, okay?
They fill out a form, regardless of the outcome.
And because there's no search done, there's some boxes to check there. It's gonna ask for his ethnicity.
That data can provide a lot of oversight when it comes to finding disproportional treatment of minorities.
Whether or not they were traffic stops because of a broken taillight or any type of thing that was happening with the car, speeding, any type of criteria that was physically seen at that particular time, or if it was running of plates and there was outstanding warrants or things along those lines that our officers saw on their computers. And so those are, again, pieces that, from a disproportionality standpoint, matter to me greatly how we're handling those and addressing those in the future.
City Council continues to see this data as a tool to improve the service our police department provides on a daily basis.
From a City Council perspective, I think that's where the community really can hold us accountable to say, you know, hey, you have this objective criteria, you're looking at this data set, and so what are you actively making sure that the police department is looking at in regards to that?
Police see the same opportunity, using the numbers to review policies on a regular basis.
We look at it for everything from deployment of resources to just standard practices and procedures to training, and it affects all of those things.
The latest data from 2016 shows that overall, the disparity in traffic stops has gone down.
How you doing?
Doing all right, how are you, sir?
Not bad, I stopped today for 76 in the 65.
Still, African-American and Hispanic drivers are proportionately stopped more frequently than white and Asian drivers. Iowa City is just one of three departments in Iowa to track this data.
I'm gonna write you a citation for operating a non-registered vehicle.
And just having that information allows police to hold the department accountable.
It'll fluctuate year to year, I'm sure that it will, but I think we're moving in the right direction, and I think it's in large part because of this study and that self-assessment.
I think our police department has made huge steps in the work that it's done with building trust, accountability, body cameras, that has us on the upward trend as we would talk about kind of overall culture with the police department and the community.
And as with any study, there's a margin of error and several variables that need to be considered. But despite its imperfections, the objective data still helps guide the department towards better service.
And there are just so many things that play into it that it's hard to say, boy, here are the one or two things that we need to fix or manipulate or do a better job at, and that will make things all better. It is hard, so we look at it and we take baby steps.
With a new police chief leading the department, the City Council sees this as a great opportunity to continue making improvements.
Having a new police chief gives us some fresh eyes. He's able to tap into some of the background that he has moving forward to see what things we could do differently.
Whether you are looking at citations, arrests, or search requests, the study is not about pointing out the flaws.
Looking in the mirror, we can see that there is disparity. We can see that there have been issues.
But more about providing an opportunity to improve them.
You know, I have a high amount of respect for what our officers are doing and the fact that they're putting, you know, their lives on the line on a regular basis, and I appreciate, you know, the police chief also wanting to address it in a more meaningful way so we can build that community trust.
The department is proud of the strides it has made and is looking forward to continued success with the study.
I would put our numbers up against just about any other agency, and I think that we would compare favorably. That doesn't mean that there still isn't room for improvement and that we couldn't provide better for our community, and that's what we're trying to do.
At a time when law enforcement has been under some public scrutiny, you made it a point to address in your swearing-in ceremony that you stand by your officers. Can you elaborate on that and talk about why that was so important for you to address?
Sure. You know, they say that keeping the peace is like sausage. Everybody likes it, but nobody likes to see it being made. And because of that, some of the tasks that these officers have to do out there, they're not pretty. It's a tough job, especially in today's society. It's a very tough job. And yet these officers go out every single day, they put the uniform on, and they serve the community and try to do what's right. With that high level of scrutiny that we're under right now, we need to make sure that these officers are confident that if they're doing things right, if they're treating people fairly, and they're acting in good faith, that we'll stand by them. They will stumble. I will stumble. And they need to be assured by the leadership of this police department that when they do, that we'll correct the issue and send them back out and they can do their job without hesitation, without worry. There's nothing worse in the world to be under a microscope. Law enforcement is. We live in glass houses, and we need to be aware of that. And these officers are trained early on in their careers that they're under scrutiny. But they have to have that support, and they have that from me. I want them to go out and do a good job and work with confidence. The citizens will be better assured that they're being kept safe, that we're keeping crime down when they know that these officers are out there and they're knowledgeable, they're well-trained, they're confident in what they do, and they're gonna get the job done and protect this community.
Clearly you've been in leadership roles before. Can you describe your approach to running a department?
I'm a very hands-on chief. I always have been. When an officer is yelling for assistance, I tend to get in my car and go. I've been in those predicaments. I've had chiefs roll up on me and help me, and I thought that was particularly important, that they know that the leader will do exactly what they'll do. That's number one. I try to be personable and have a friendly disposition with the officers. We certainly have a professional relationship that needs to be maintained. I say I have an open door policy, but I pay particular attention to the chain of command. I value our command staff here, and they're an integral part. And so I make sure that everybody's aware that we don't bypass the leadership here, and that we have that unity of command, that there's one person you report to and there's a chain of command. But these officers also know that I will show up at roll call. I may show up on a call with them. I'm not trying to micromanage. I want them to know that I'm there for them, and I want to see what's going on. And I think the officers will appreciate that I'm not making decisions based on, sitting in an ivory tower and not, understanding the ramifications that those decisions are going to have. That's the kind of leaders I liked working for, and that's what I insist on being here.
Most people know you by your credentials and seeing your picture in the paper. Can you tell us something about yourself from outside of work and some of the things you like to do?
I've got a wife, Laura. I've got three children. They're all grown, so we're empty nesters. Two of them live in Iowa, and one lives in Michigan. Laura and I, now that we're empty nesters, enjoy the activities in town. And that's one of the reasons we moved here as well. We're big sports fans, naturally, so we'll be following the university sports at all levels. But we truly just enjoy, if nothing else, walking down to the Ped Mall and having dinner and window shopping and just spending time together. So, I balance my professional and personal life. I have fun at work, but I also like my downtime. And the two meld together. And I encourage the officers to do the same thing. Don't make it all work. Conversely, don't come to work and make it too much work. Have fun here. Be professional, but have a good time. And that'll balance your life very well. And I think I've done well with that in my last 34 years in this job.
Well, Chief Matherly, thank you so much for meeting with me. I appreciate it.
Well, thank you very much.
Best of luck in the new role.
Thank you, sir.
There are over 75,000 people who depend on the Iowa City water plant each day. It's a responsibility that is not taken lightly. Let's take a look at how the plant uses state-of-the-art technology to create a superior product. We use it every day for things like cleaning, washing, showering, and of course, drinking. But do you ever stop to think about how clean, safe water makes it to your home? If you're like me, you haven't given it much thought. But given it's the most vital resource that the city provides, it's not a bad idea to be familiar with the process. When the city decided to relocate its water facility in 2003, selecting a site near the Iowa River was key. By being located in the nook of the river, the city was able to develop 5 sources of raw water. The plant can draw from the river, a sand pit, an alluvial aquifer, and then 2 deep wells, the Solarian and Jordan aquifers.
The city can use a combination of any of those sources, but one is the most effective for creating clean, raw water.
Our primary source here is the alluvial aquifer. We use our collector wells to obtain that water.
The groundwater collected by this well is mostly from the Iowa River. So how is it different?
The sand and gravel in the alluvial aquifer acts as a natural filter. And so the water that comes into the plant, our raw water, is really already filtered by the sand and gravel in the alluvial aquifer.
It sounds strange, but Craig explained that the sand and gravel actually clean the water as it makes its way from the river to the well.
Turbidity, the dirt and particles in the water are removed, and organics that cause taste and odor are also removed.
I'm likely not alone here, but turbidity is not a part of my daily vocabulary. Simply put, it is the cloudiness or haziness of a fluid caused by a large number of individual particles. It's generally pretty hard to see, but is easily tested for. This is measured by nephelometric turbidity units, or NTUs. The measurement of turbidity is a key test for water quality. To display the difference, we decided to draw samples from both the river and the alluvial aquifer.
So the difference between the river, which is changeable and can go up to hundreds of NTUs, and our consistent source of collector well water, which is always a right around 0.1 or under. So that's kind of what we want to show today.
Once removed from its muddy banks, the Iowa River is actually surprisingly clear, but obviously not safe to drink.
So this is our sample of river water that we just pulled out from the river. It's a turbidity of probably 15 or 20 NTU, which is nephelometric turbidity units. Our finished water generally is 0.05 in that range.
The alluvial aquifer that we have been discussing is literally only about 100 yards up the road from the river.
So we're going to compare this to the river sample we grabbed earlier, see if we can detect visually any difference in turbidity. Turbidity is pretty hard to pick up by the human eye, but we may be able to see a little bit of difference here.
As Kevin draws his sample, you already notice the difference.
The sample on your left is the river sample that we collected, and the sample on your right is the sample that we just collected from our collector well.
It's not drastic, but certainly the sample from the well is more clear. And that beginning product can make a big difference when purifying water.
The alluvial aquifer creates a raw water, a really high quality raw water, low in turbidity and low in organics.
Given the importance of these wells, the city took extra precautions after the 2008 flood, raising all electrical equipment high off the ground and installing flood doors to keep water out.
They were projecting the highest that we would ever really need to worry about is about 4 feet. If it even got close to that, this door splits in half so we could boat up and have access to get inside to check our equipment for just going through this top portion of the door.
This ensures that Kevin and his team can draw from any combination of these sources, even during flood events. Even though the raw product has less turbidity, it still has bacteria and other imperfections that need to be removed. The city's state-of-the-art purification process includes 6 steps. First, the aerator removes gases such as CO2 and ammonia. From there, the water goes to the softening phase, where lime is added to remove calcium.
We take out about 2/3 of the hardness out in this process.
Next, the water moves to the recarbonation tanks to remove the remaining hardness and lower pH levels. The water then moves to the granular active carbon filters, which removes all remaining organics.
It does a really great job of creating a barrier between the river and our customers.
For the next 3 to 4 hours, the water is mixed in the chlorine contact tanks.
So we get a really good, high quality level of disinfection in the water.
The now clean, safe to drink water is kept in storage tanks until it is sent out to the city using high pressure pumps. It's a complex process, but with 75,000 people counting on your performance each day, the staff here is committed to exact precision.
Over the years, Iowa City has made a name for itself in the culinary world, but the growing trend of food on four wheels has not been a big part of that process. Now the city is dipping its toe in the water of a late night food truck scene with the start of a new pilot program.
Up until this point, we haven't really had enough vending opportunities to prove our perspective.
Chef Kyle Seek started Local Burrito 9 years ago, selling food in stores, at the farmer's market, even catering weddings. He bought his food truck 4 years ago.
People like food trucks. It's a fun thing. It's a hip thing. Any big city has a food truck scene.
Kyle is part of a group participating in the pilot program, hoping to create a more diverse food scene.
That contributes to the community and the culture, and that's really what it's about for me.
Before we dive too deep into the details of the pilot program, let's first establish the current rules that food trucks play by. The current ordinance allows food truck vendors to operate from 7 a.m. to 9 p.m. They're allowed to park in 1 and 2 hour metered spaces for up to 3 hours, but food trucks can't be downtown, in the Northside Marketplace, or within 150 feet of any restaurant. Those rules fall in line with how many cities manage food trucks, but a group of vendors led by Chef Kyle see room for growth.
We received a proposal from the Iowa City Mobile Vending Association that was asking us to explore food truck operations over the late night hours.
And the city council agreed that it was worth taking a look at a late night setup for food trucks. In order to establish the rules of the pilot program, mobile vendors in the city met with brick and mortar restaurants to hear their concerns.
You know, our downtown restaurants really are a large part of what makes the downtown what it is, and we don't want to do anything that would adversely affect them.
Though the conversations were spirited at times, the groups were able to find common ground.
It's not a war. We're not trying to fight or steal or compete. It's, like I said, it's like we're just trying to figure out where's our place, you know, what is the next step, and so this is what we're trying now.
Here's the plan for the pilot. For 3 months, food trucks will be able to operate on Friday and Saturday nights in select locations. The hours will be from 10 to 2, and the locations all fall outside of that 150-foot buffer zone. It all kicks off on March 31st at the Robert A. Lee Recreation Area parking lot along Burlington Avenue.
That will be really to draw attention to the pilot. It'll be the first night of operations through the pilot. We really hope that that gets some good word of mouth out there, that people know that this program is happening.
This will be the only time that all 6 participating trucks will be able to set up at once. Following the kickoff event, the food trucks will be able to set up on North Clinton Street from April 7th to 29th. Only 4 trucks will be able to set up each night. Those will be determined by the Mobile Vending Association. The program then moves back to the recreation area parking lot for 5 weeks. That includes all of May and the first weekend in June. Lastly, the food trucks will be set up along North Dubuque Street, just north of Iowa Avenue. Feedback that is collected during the pilot will be presented to City Council, which can then decide if any permanent changes should be made to the ordinance.
Really, it allows the public, restaurants, vendors, the university to weigh in on what they witnessed throughout the course of the pilot and what they want to see long term for how the city regulates these.
For Kyle and the other vendors, it's an opportunity to show that food trucks can be a vital part of the food scene without being detrimental to brick and mortar restaurants.
I would just like to see everything run smoothly. People do business, students and citizens enjoy it.
And it's possible that the pilot may not change anything with the city ordinance, but the chance to explore the opportunity is what excites Chef Kyle.
It's been such a rewarding thing for my life, and I think it could be good for other people too. So just how do we grow this so other people can participate? So hopefully we can find solutions that accomplish that.
Next time on Iowa City in Focus, learn about the city's new curbside compost program and how you can help reduce food waste. And let us know what topics you would like to see covered in future shows. Email us at info.citychannel4.com or reach us on Facebook by liking the City of Iowa City government page. Thanks for watching. We'll see you next time on Iowa City in Focus.